My name is Darren Hickey. I'm the Better Beef Project Leader, and I'm based over in Bairnsdale. And it's my job this afternoon to introduce Tom Hicks, our next speaker. Tom is from Hicks Beef, and their operation is based at Holbrook and Jingellic. Hicks Beef operation consists of around 1,400 breeders and consisting of Red Angus and composite cows, and Hicks Beef is also involved in some trading activity when the season permits. Tom's here today to talk to us about the breeding strategy that's been incorporated into Hicks Beef, and how crossbreeding has been has become an important part of that strategy, and the benefits that crossbreeding delivers to their business. So I've got my pleasure now to hand over to Tom. If you'll join me in welcoming Tom. Thank you.
My name is Tom Hicks. I'm from Holbrook, New South Wales. I've been working the family business since 2010. Prior to that, I was at Marcus Oldham from 2007 to 2009. Please don't hold that against me. Before that, I was a station hand at Headingley Station in Queensland from 2005 to 2006, where I learnt what not to do. We have two properties in New South Wales, Annandale South, where the stud cattle are run, which comprises 4,800 acres, and the rainfall 750 mils with granite soils. And South Bend, which is located at Jingellic, is used for backgrounding heifers, steers, and some commercial cows. There's 1,700 acres there with 850 mil rainfall. We run 1,400 breeders, comprising of 750 Australian beef composite cows recorded on multi-breed register and 250 Red Angus studs plus 400 composite commercial cows. And when the season permits, 300 trade heifers and steers. We sell through a variety of markets. Younger stock go through auctions plus or the yards at 300 to 380 kilos. In the past, cattle were sold to the feedlots at 380 to 420 kilos. But over the past 2 years, we've been selling through Coles Graze program from 420 to 520 kilos. Cattle have to be grass-fed since birth with a minimum fat cover of 5 mils. Our focus. We aim to produce practical, easy-care cattle that are profitable in the real world. Fertility is number one. It is the single most important trait, outweighing growth and carcass attributes. For this reason, our cattle must conceive within a 6-week joining period. We aim to increase the number of calves conceived in the first cycle. As calves conceived in the first cycle are on average 30 kilograms heavier at weaning than calves conceived in the second cycle. Cows must have and wean a calf every year. They must all calve unassisted. Anything that doesn't is culled. Now, heifers have minimal supervision, and cows have no supervision. We aim to balance growth rather than maximum growth, as extreme growth females require too much energy for maintenance. Docility is also a key part of our program. It's a highly heritable trait, provides ease of handling, reduces personal injury, OHS is becoming a bigger and bigger thing, increases MSA compliance through less dark cutters. Structure cannot be forgotten. Animals' breeding lives should not be cut short due to poor structure. Surplus females can be sold as PTIC cows rather than chopper cows, increasing market versatility. Carcass quality for market compliance, such as eye muscle area, IMF, and optimum fat colour. Breeding and crossbreeding for target markets. Generally, producers breed cattle based on emotion and tradition more so than economics and science. Often breeds are handed down from generation to generation rather than selected for market specifications and suitability to the environment. Rather than having an emphasis on one specific breed, it is more important to develop a clear understanding of the drivers of profit in a cattle enterprise. Without this understanding, it is impossible to make educated breeding decisions. Once the drivers have been identified, a clear plan is needed. This must incorporate genetics, management, and the environment. Establishing which market should be targeted comes down to profitability. This varies from year to year. For this reason, it is important to remain flexible. Focus on a market that is profitable in your environment in an average rainfall year. There is no sense aiming a market that is only possible in a top 10% rainfall year. Drivers of profit. There are a vast range of traits that influence profitability, but some have a greater influence than others. The American Simmental Association rates maternal traits such as fertility, calving ease, calf survival and cow longevity have a greater effect on profitability than growth and carcass traits, as dead calves and empty cows are not profitable in any system. Crossbreeding can impact many traits, but is especially useful in improving the performance of lowly heritable traits, which are also coincidentally major profit drivers, as mentioned previously, reproduction and calf survivability. Lowly heritable traits are harder to change through genetics. This is not to say they cannot be changed, it is just a slow process. This is a key point, as these same traits that are difficult and time-consuming to change through straight breeding genetics are traits that have a huge impact on profitability, and all can easily be improved through utilisation of hybrid vigour. According to the North Carolina State University, heritability is a percent of variation in performance due to genetic effects rather than environment. This table shows when breed A, on the left there, is crossed with breed B, the fertility of the resulting progeny, breed AB, are superior to that of the parent breeds. This table shows the difference in heritability in certain traits. It can be expressed as it is above, from 0 to 1, or as a percentage. The heritability of calving rate is 2% to 17%, making it a lowly heritable trait, whilst mature cow weight is highly heritable at 50%. Cow efficiency. It is easier to sell increased animal production, such as weight gain and carcass, than it is to sell efficiency, such as fertility and longevity. It does not have the same romance to it, and it is harder to measure. Cow efficiency is the key to a low-cost production system. Moderately framed cattle don't consume as much as large-framed animals. And even though they might not wean as much in total weight, as a percentage of their body weight, the moderately framed cattle are superior. Heifers are expensive to bring into the system, especially if they empty after their first calf. You've spent all the time, energy and money on getting them to calving weight, as well as the labour on checking on them. So for them to be empty is a disaster. After calving, she's growing and lactating at the same time, so generally are in poorer condition than cows, and then therefore worth less money. Often the cattle in the empty pen are the late calvers, as they don't have enough time to recover post-calving. The best way to stop these coming in empty is to have a tight joining period, from 6 weeks for heifers to 6 to 8 weeks for cows, but preferably 6 weeks for cows as well. Fetal ultrasounding rather than manual preg testing is a more effective way of identifying late calvers. It is important to sell these cattle when possible. Our aim is to have as tight a calving as possible, so we cull on calving date rather than the age of the cow. A tight calving pattern is a sign of good herd fertility, as all cows are conceiving early in the joining period. Genetics versus the environment. No matter how good your genetics are, they cannot achieve a desirable outcome if the management system is inadequate. Environmental factors are out of our control, but the impact of unfavourable environmental factors can be reduced through planning. In dry times, it has to be a clear decision made what the most economically viable decision is. There is no point spending thousands on feed if it is financially unsustainable in the long term. Trigger points must be in place to ensure stocking rates are matched to the season. It is critical that if it does not rain by a set point in time, that stock are sold, put on adjustment, extra feed is bought. Examples of trigger points we use: selling older commercial cows rather than carving them down, sell steers to the feedlot rather than finishing them from culls, sell commercial heifers rather than retaining them for breeding. As mentioned previously, matching your genetics to your environment is essential. A certain type of animal may be profitable in one environment but unprofitable in another. The utilisation of breed complementarity is an extremely useful tool to improve market adaptability. A prime example of this is a first cross ewe. The Merino ewe brings the fleece, whilst the Border Leicester brings increased weight gain and carcass quality. The outcome is an animal that cuts wool and produces good quality carcasses at the same time. Everyone has a different set of goals they wish to achieve. In order to accomplish these goals, a well set out plan is a necessity to help guide the program in the right direction. These goals need to be well thought out and have the final outcome in mind. What are you trying to achieve? Is it maximum weight at weaning, maximum 400 day weight, or steers for the Japanese market? Do you need to breed for replacement females or a terminal female program? Is that better suited? It is important to design a breeding system that incorporates your specific goals, whether it is a straight or crossbreeding program. How to achieve these goals? It is one thing to set goals, is another thing to achieve them. Measure production traits. You can't manage what you don't measure. A disciplined breeding program backed by science. Choose bulls with EBVs that suit your market. Match the production system to the environment. Many producers realise there are production gains that can be made through the utilisation of hybrid vigour, but they are worried that crossbreeding systems are complicated and hard to manage. These issues can be overcome through management strategies that focus on optimum hybrid vigour rather than maximum hybrid vigour. Examples of breeding systems are: rotational crossbreeding systems can produce great results, but these systems can be difficult to implement. Many different mobs are needed at joining to ensure that the right bull goes over the right cow. Purebred systems are easy to manage compared to rotational crossbreeding programs. However, they do not utilise hybrid vigour. Composites are easy to manage, whilst utilising hybrid vigour at the same time. You can have your cake and eat it too. The Meat Animal Research Centre, or MARC, in the USA is the largest red meat research centre in the world. They've done extensive work on the advantages of composite cattle. Their aim was to find the most effective way to utilise hybrid vigour. The rationale for developing composite cattle were as follows. The average herd size was too small to effectively implement a rotational crossbreeding system. Fluctuations in breed composition can lead to inconsistencies in cattle bred in rotational systems. This does not apply to composite cattle, as the breed composition is always constant. Composites are an effective way to utilise the vast range of desirable traits available across a variety of breeds. It is important to note that breeds may be of such poor genetic quality that they cancel out any gains made through hybrid vigour. In order for crossbreeding programs to be successful, it has to be simple yet effective. Select breeds that excel in economically relevant traits and complement each other. The MARC has long held that 50% British and 50% European makeup will provide the economically optimum end product. The British breed offers a superior carcass quality, whilst the European breeds provide increased weight gain and yield. Select superior size. EBVs are by far the most effective tools for making genetic progress. This is because they leverage all available information, pedigree, adjusted data, and DNA tests to predict genetic value. All bulls used must have EBVs, and they must have good EBVs. Measuring genetic inputs and outputs. It is important that hybrid vigour is not seen as a silver bullet. The genetic inputs have to be high quality and well considered. The use of EBVs is essential in any program, straight or crossed. In the past, it has been difficult to use EBVs to evaluate across breeds, as they all use different data sets. Now there is a true breed evaluation through American Simmental Association that allows different breeds to be evaluated on the same database. With 16 million animals from 10 breeds in the database, it is one of the largest cattle databases in the world. They process data from American Simmental, American Red Angus, American and Canadian Gelfie, Canadian Angus, Canadian Red Angus, and Canadian Simmental, and they also incorporate American Angus data. As mentioned previously, EBVs are a must. If we are If we are to effectively predict the genetic value of our herds, they are not perfect, but they are by far the best tool we have. It can be hard to understand EBVs, as there are numerous traits recorded, and it seems more get added each year. This is where index are valuable. They blend individual EBVs and economics to estimate animals' overall impact on the bottom line. This table shows the weightings for Angus Australia's domestic index. It puts a strong emphasis on the following EBVs: 400 day weight, retail beef yield, calving ease, days to calving, IMF, maternal calving ease. Being a domestic index, there is a large emphasis on 400 day weight, as this is the age this market wants its cattle killed. The long fed index, for example, has very little emphasis on the 400 day weight. As its name suggests, in this market, cattle are killed a lot older. Therefore, it has a larger focus on 600 day weight. The competition. Since the 1980s, the amount of chicken eaten per capita has doubled, from 20 kilograms per person per year to 46 kilograms per person per year, whilst beef and lamb consumption has decreased from 50 kilograms per person to 35 per person. Why is this? As you can see, the retail price for chicken has been relatively constant over the last 20 years. This has been a huge advantage for the chicken industry. This table shows the increase in the efficiencies that have occurred in the chicken industry. In 1975, it used to take 65 days to get to 2 kilograms live weight. Now it takes just 35 days, whilst also vastly improving feed conversion. The gains made in the chicken industry have been made possible by having vertically integrated multinational companies. They own the animal from birth to the consumer's plate. They know what drives profit in every aspect of their business. Profit is the number one goal. There is no sentimental attachments to a specific breed or production system. If science proved there are changes that could improve the bottom line, they are implemented. It would be an exaggeration to say that all of the gains made in the chicken industry can be attributed to hybrid vigour. There are other factors that have contributed to the progress. Multiple generations can be produced within 1 year, rather than one cow per calf per year. This intensive system the chickens are run under are more constant, meaning there are fewer environmental factors affecting the genetics of individual animals, making it easier to evaluate the genetic merit of an individual animal. However, in saying this, it would not have been possible to make these gains without hybrid vigour. There would not be a large-scale poultry producer in the world that did not utilise hybrid vigour. What has this got to do with the beef industry? Currently, the beef industry is seeing record high prices, and things are looking pretty bright. But there is a risk that beef could be pushed to the side of the plate by cheaper forms of protein. By 2050, there is projected to be 9 billion people in the world. We're going to have to produce more food from less. And if beef is going to compete on this stage, large efficiencies have to be made. Hybrid vigour is one of the tools that needs to be capitalised on for us to remain competitive in the future. In conclusion, focus on profit. Fertility is number one, and cow longevity. Select cattle that suit your environment and the target markets. Breed complementarity offers a wide range of traits. Use selection index to target your market. Set goals, know what traits are needed, and match your genetics to the environment. It is easier to change genetics than the environment. And select the right bulls with EBVs. Thank you.